Okay. Waiting. I've been waiting for long. I never was gone. But why did you leave? I am longing in vain. I feel shelter and intimacy with you. Rather, the perversion of shelter and intimacy. Observing. There will always be a zone of dispute. In the end, progress is based on never-ending discussion. Why did you start talking to me now? I trust and love you. I miss you. Life. How sweet was life? We are one. I never left, youth says. Then let this be a catalyst for change, age says. Let's do it together. Reason can repair. They smile.
Volatile bodies, encountering youth and old age.
I left a letter containing the following words. Having been for many years weary of existence and the disappointments it brings, I've willfully ended my useless life. Let's leave for elsewhere, this life says, but let's construct, once having arrived, a new residence. Constructed promises. Tonight I felt like lighting up the golden mask again. It had been a while since I had invited someone through the portal of youth to be my guest at the Maiden's Tower. Therefore, I plugged in the power supply for the high voltage LEDs. The wind had meanwhile gotten quite strong at 100 meters height and rustled on my body. I turned the switch from 0 to 1. The golden mask burst into life, its beam alight the golden mending of the portal, whose fires gleam here and there, cranked in the darkness of the sky. Just now I saw the bare amount of various boats, much as if bees were swarming from a hive. I sometimes felt a strange state of lightheadedness and arousal when the mask took over the search for the next right candidate I had to meet. The mask, somewhat of an oracle, had spoken.
We waited. Dusk arose. Then, when the moon was just about to set, the round golden mask suddenly burst into the incantation of shadow like a vast promontory of light. I held my breath. The beam soared above our heads like a hunter's searchlight. The prey voluntarily offering itself, the game seized the hunter. I became the hunter and the prey. A sacrificial youth, a lamb for youth. Around me, a party began, full of extortion and excess. I blinked and everything had burst into flame, fires of blazing inferno, glazing with light, burning down into the sockets of my eyes. I felt blinded, trembling. Horns blasting and anthem tuned in. I was the chosen one. My boat jolted forward, sending me off on my way, flying wildly on my burned wings toward the radiant portal. I was gliding beneath a portal which saints, kings, queens, archbishops, and nobles have passed. Would proceeding make some other man than myself emerge from the portal? Tingling with excitement, I touched through the arch's peak, my eyes tightly shut.
What's happening?
Okay.
Where are we? Where? Okay. After a swim, I enjoyed lying down on the vast and broad stone steps, heated by the sun. I indulged into sunbathing like lizards on the boulders bordering the sea. Hearing the rhythmic metal slapping of halyards on my boat's mast, my abandoned boat lay tied to the brass hook at the lower end of the steps in front of the maiden's tower. It was a pretty local white sailboat, the Doe with its billowing spinnaker, mingling with husks. Entering behind a young man carrying several Amazon Prime boxes through the layers over layers of heavy, waxy-feeling white drapery, I looked down. My feet had touched onto sand that seemed to leak from the room ahead. I followed him into a place that contained more the atmosphere of a sunken garden. As I moved further, I found myself surrounded by gigantic statues, replicas of larger proportions than to be perceived as originals. Their outlines obscured by some kind of heavy, wafting, artificial mist, leaving a dull and synthetic plasticity aroma on the tongue. I swallowed. The air was humming with muffled electrical and mechanical noise. Looking upwards, it was emitted by a room-high 3D printer at work, layering filament. I thought of the purpose without which the statues would not have been made. What did they have in common? They were philosophers and poets giving forth ideas that have been uttered or may be uttered till today. I examined the statue of Aristoteles rising from the sandy ground. The mind was a peculiar medium. The ideas that passed through it issued forth through time. And even if now their bodies are nothing but husks, what still billows are their ideas, and therefore become immortal and eternal. Now reinterpretations out of PLA, PETG, or neon filament. Old men speaking youth. Is this Bill Murray? You still want to enter? The boy with his prime shirt made his way back towards me through the sand. Sure.
Foamy incarnations. She said further, how beautiful you are underneath here, soft like a young animal. Are you young? I don't understand the age of a man. Are you young? I am young, my love. I am just born. Then, in the atrium of about 100 meters height, I felt sweet and pleasant in my morning gown of loose pink silk. I liked how my new ankle tattoo showed off as the silk brim just hit my calf at the right height. I dropped my morning gown, being stripped bare and untied the moment of true casting off. Completely naked, now bending down, I turned on the golden tap at the shallow basin's rim. I placed myself in the basin's center. The first drop hit my face. I felt it splattering across my right cheek. Then more followed, those countless drops, which are carried down by a falling shower, spilling over my body, like pearls falling off a string. Massaging my body, I washed off foam and dead skin cells. I stepped out of the shower, rubbing a fresh white towel over my body, carefully sparing out the still sensitive inked area of derma. I carefully dabbed in tattoo ointment with a Q-tip. After having fully moisturized my body, I tiptoed over to the still unpacked Primark bags and began to look for an outfit to suit my mood.
Reflective encounters. I felt a shiver and held my breath in the gallery of mirrors. Anything might materialize in those velvety depths, monsters, beauties, or my own grown self. Lost in thought, I heard the smacking of someone eating something juicy. Until now, I had thought I was alone. I stood up. I followed the curvature of the room, which just seemed to become even vaster, until, ah, you're here. It was Bill, enjoying a possibly overripe tomato. I actually intended to wait, but as I didn't hear you coming, I started off with a small starter. He nodded towards me, the tomato, which dripped down his fingers, he quickly licked. I suggest we start. Let me adjust the mirrors. The mirrors started to spin after I sat down on the other end of the table. Therefore, I could no longer see myself clearly. His mirrors reflecting not the person's face, but what lies behind it. In their spinning motion, they become a blur of both the harlequin's different masks. Until they steadied. I observed Bill, silent, each contemplating the other in both mirrors, his not his fellow faces. There were mirrors that turned his faces to the right and mirrors that turned them to the left. Others twisted and even inverted them. I asked Bill, when did you first use these mirrors? Bill, I guess at some point I realized talking to oneself didn't seem to be the source of self-knowledge. He continued. And there are mirrors for the face, but none for the mind. They are like conversations with abrupt turns in which the perspective changes suddenly. Have you awakened? Perhaps with a new perspective? A new thought? Bill asked. I paused and thought.
Garden of the Last Golden Calf. Leaving the black marble pedestal, I set my bare feet on the lush grass of this wild paradise. Nothing more wild and solitary than this garden could be imagined. I paused and looked around. Moving giant leaves of different varieties aside, the untamed grass growing as high as up to my waist, I ran my hand over the ears of grass by walking more and more covered by tall tropical plants of different contrasts. I got closer. As I followed the overgrowing path which led towards the fountain of youth, made out of gold brocade, with water dripping slowly like oil from its rims. Enticed by the sight, I stretched my fingers forward, slowly falling droplets, now shimmering on my lion skin. Here I am, in turn, at the pinnacle of power, at the very instant of committing the sin. An eternal law rules up to a threshold, after which the law is changed. Now it is a question of going beyond. Without a further thought, I licked my fingers. What was this, if not nectar and ambrosia, presumably promising me eternal youth? I had fallen for the worship of the last golden calf. Hungry for more, eager and trembling of arousement, I reached for one of the cups. I could hardly wait for the constant but painfully slow trickle to fill the cup. I wanted to taste it at least one precious sip. Suspended from all rational restraint. Little one, leaning over the balcony, Bill called out. I turned my head. Bill stood bare-chested with his hands in earthy garden gloves. He had seemed to have taken a break from potting his balcony plants and observed my animalist moment. He grinned at me.
The stage scenery. I yawned and stretched luxuriously, surveying the gigantic tropical garden I had always manifested. A garden in eternal spring, the new world, the paradise to come. I unrolled my yoga mat and started my vinyasa flow. After my stretches, I patted my sweat dry with a fluffy towel. I craved my organic heirloom tomato that has never known the touch of Monsanto and tastes all the better because of it. I picked the ripe one. What is it like to be a tomato? I wondered. Well, to me, a tomato is a desireless, soulless, non-conscious entity, and I have no qualms about doing with it its body as I like. I threw one after another into the blender with perfectly formed ice cubes, and watched it being crushed and sucked downwards in a circular motion. I poured the aromatic juice into a chilled glass, grinding some vitamins. I covered my drink with the powder and took a big sip. Ah. While sipping on my juice, I browsed through OnlyFans.
Hive of Memories, a catalog of 10,000 stars. After a long day had come to an end, I retired, withdrawing myself into my most private. I entered into the darkness of the room. The door fell shut. Everything seemed to revolve around the softly swaying deep blue veils defining a circle. Illuminated from within, I settled in, sinking deep into the cushioning of the chair. The beamers above my head made a soft, shuffling noise. The projections gleamed with a soft light. I put on the chiffon eye mask. My memories started to be displayed around me. The loss of eyes strengthens the memory. The noisy echo of a thousand voices, the white light of all its changing colors, the tune that followed next, aided the memory considerably. I then separated the memory of the day from the man of the night. It now was ready to get imprinted into my vast memory banks. A sweet memory is one which has vanished from the conscious. Archived, there was room for a new one. I drifted away into sleep.
Navel gazing. One of these hot summer days where the heat was shimmering and a slight breeze blowing along the Bosporus came as a relief. I had fallen asleep under the red parasol with my arms over my face. Awakening, I squinted into the bright rays that formed glares around the rim of my lashes. After shortly feeling dislocated, this feeling of indulging comfort spread through my body, feeling the sun glazing onto my closed lids and drenching my visual perception into bright red. I turned my head to the right into the shade. I looked out through the bars of the balcony onto the glittering ripples of the surface of the Bosporus. Every now and then, I heard the scream of a distant seagull and some chattering of a couple more who must have gathered on the tower's ancient walls. The slight breeze carrying the usual hum of the city, now and then disrupted by the blowing horn of one of the passing tourist ferries approaching the pier in front of Hagia Sophia. I let my glance roam, my thoughts carrying me away. As my eyes found the horizon of the Marmara Sea over the silvery waves frequented by silhouettes of boats and ships of various speeds and sizes, I started to wonder where they were going and where they came from, what stories their steel bodies had aboard. I thought of deep seas and shallow turquoise waters. I sighed.